The Big Scottish Football Podcast with Stephen Mill and Ewen Cameron.
Hello and welcome to the Big Scottish Football Podcast. It is episode 88. I'm Stephen Mill. He's Ewen Cameron. Hope you're doing all right. How are you, Ewen Cameron, this morning?
I'm doing good this morning. I felt like shit yesterday.
Why was that?
Well, we spent the weekend together.
We did.
We had a wee day out in Newcastle.
A night out in Newcastle.
A day and a night out in Newcastle.
How did you feel shit yesterday? Because you didn't have a lot to drink. I mean, I felt terrible yesterday.
But you were drinking Red Stripe.
I love Red Stripe. One of my favourite lagers.
It is quite a lethal beer though, isn't it?
Yeah, no, it's good. I like it though.
So, yeah, I'll be honest with you. It was a really good weekend because we host the big Saturday football show. And because it was the last day of the league campaign, we had a night out at Newcastle after the show. Mm-hmm. So we jumped on a train, headed into Newcastle. We went, got ourselves in the hotel, had a quick shower, got changed. Oh, actually, Producer John, listen to this. You listen, Producer John.
I am all right. Ears, Ewen.
I hang about with mingers. I hang about with smelly gits. So we're on air on the radio at 12 noon until 4 o'clock. Mm-hmm. And then at 4:30 we catch a train from Edinburgh Waverley to go to Newcastle.
Yeah.
We get to Newcastle at around 6 o'clock, 6 o'clock. It's a 5-minute walk from the train station to get to the hotel. I'm sharing a room with Producer Rory. Stephen is sharing a room with Steve Cowan, the former Hibs and Aberdeen striker. Mm-hmm. So Producer Rory and I get to the room, we undress and we get a shower. We wash and we prepare ourselves for the night ahead.
Not together.
We didn't shower together, no.
Yeah, just to clarify.
I'm not his type. And he's got a fiancé.
Yeah.
But Steve and Stephen Mill went into the room.
Dumped their stuff and went straight to the pub.
Straight to the pub.
Yeah.
I mean, that is just... And they're messaging me like 15 minutes after we've just got into the hotel room. Where are yous? Where are yous? What yous doing? I went, I'm having a shower. And I sent him a picture with me in my white towel. Do you remember getting that picture?
Yeah, but I don't understand what the problem is here.
You're a stinking minger.
I showered on Saturday morning.
Right. What time did you get up on Saturday?
I don't know, about 9:30.
9:30. You had a shower.
Yeah.
You then go to work.
Yep.
You then sit on a train.
Yep.
You then get to Newcastle.
Yep.
Get to the hotel room.
Yep.
You take off what you were wearing.
Yep.
You put on your clothes for the night.
Yep.
Douse yourself with some deodorant, I'm guessing.
Probably.
Using a smell to cover up a stinking body odour smell. And then you go out.
I don't know.
Why was the rush? It was 6 o'clock at night. Go and have a...
I don't know what you think I did between having a shower and then later. It's not normal to have 2 showers a day.
Did you not have a poo at some point before we went out at Newcastle?
What's that got to do with anything?
Hold on,
what's that got to do with anything?
Do you have a shower after every time you defecate?
Is that what you're trying to say? Because if that's what you're saying, then you're very much in the minority here, I would suggest. You're very much in the minority.
Let's just rewind this whole thing, Ewan. Come on.
Well, should we start the show again?
No. I'm intrigued now.
No, I mean, that's mental what you just said. Right. I'm hosting a radio show. It's not manual labour that I'm doing. I'm just sat on a seat like I am just now.
But it was a hot, sweaty day.
We were in a studio that was air conditioned, but and then we're on a train that was air conditioned.
I know, but I just...
If you want to have a shower, then that's totally fine. I felt fine.
So I had a shower before Producer Rory.
Right.
And when I came out of the shower, you and Steve Cowan are messaging me, where are you? What are you doing? Where are you? What are you doing? I've only been in around 15, 20 minutes and you're already sat in the bar with a beer.
Right, fine.
But what was the rush? Why couldn't you just wash yourself, clean yourself?
Because I didn't need to.
I was clean.
How many times do you shower a day?
Twice.
Right, okay, that's abnormal.
That's really not abnormal. If you have a shower during the day, you have one at night before you go to your bed.
Nah.
You don't?
Absolutely never. Unless I've been playing fives or something like that.
Especially when you're in and out the toilet all day and everything.
What do you mean you're in and out the... I think we've uncovered something
here. Do you know what
you're
it is?
You're in and out the toilet all day. Okay. I would suggest making an appointment with your GP.
Right. I'll be honest. So, as a lot of people who listen to this podcast will know, 16 years I lived in the Middle East. And what do they have in bathrooms in the Middle East?
A wee bidet.
They have the bidet thing. So I was douching myself
Right.
I would sit on a bidet.
Right.
And water.
Why don't you just get a bidet in your house now? Because you can get them here.
Can you?
Of course you can.
Okay.
My mate's got a Japanese toilet. One of the ones that you sit on and...
You press the button.
And press the button.
And it douches you.
Yep.
I don't think anyone listening to this podcast has a bidet.
No, I don't think...
It's a rarity. It's a rarity in Scotland.
Here's a challenge.
I agree.
Here's a challenge, and if there's anyone out there that has a bidet in the house, take a picture of it and send it to us.
No, don't send a picture of your bidet.
Just your bidet.
Just get in
touch. Not you on the bidet, just you with a bidet, because I've got friends, I've got family, I've been to loads of houses over the years in Scotland, and every bathroom I've ever went into, nobody has a bidet.
I know one person that has a bidet in Scotland.
Oh, do you?
Fred McCauley.
George Bowie has a bidet.
George Bowie has a bidet? Yeah.
George Bowie of GBX
Shut
fame.
Up.
Yes, he does. He has a bidet. And there was an incident with one of the Clyde One presenters when they went back to his house who mistaken it for a toilet.
No, for a trough.
Thought there was two toilets. Oh, God. And when one of them was a bidet, and we won't go into details on what happened after that.
I mean, that's staggering on a couple of levels. The fact that there is actually somebody in Scotland who has a bidet. Who are you phoning?
George Bowie.
Right, okay. Right, that's fine.
I need to ask him a question.
He was still in the office when...
Is he still here? Is he still in the building?
He's in the studio, yeah.
Is he having a meeting? Or is he in the studio working?
Yeah. Or he might be going home now. He might be. So George has a bidet.
Welcome to the EE.
When he sees it, he'll phone me back. But yeah. I want to ask him a question about his bidet.
So he has a bidet and he also has an electric bike. Because when I speak to him, I'm like, oh, did you cycle into work this morning, George? He's like, yeah, I cycled in. I was like, no, you didn't. You have a fucking motorbike to get into work. That's not cycling.
No. I've had a shot of it outside in the car park. It's really good.
There was a few times when I think I must have been like in early in the morning covering something or something. And I was going back home and I was cycling home and so was George. And I would leave probably about 10 minutes before George. And then I would be cycling along, like if you know where we are in Clydebank, the cycle tracks sort of heading back towards Glasgow. All I would get was like, you know, a ring of the bell. I look back, it was George Bowie on his bike zooming past me.
30 mile an hour.
Not even a bead of sweat because he's got a motorbike. So,
before we go any further, so the bidet, hopefully George will phone me back. So anyway, Smelly Gits in Newcastle, Steve Cowan, former footballer, and Stephen Mill, Smelly Gits. Great night out in Newcastle. And John, producer John, I cannot thank you enough for the recommendation for Cozy Joe's in Newcastle.
It's a shame
was brilliant.
I wasn't invited, but you know.
Well, it doesn't matter. Yeah. We didn't miss you.
Maybe next year.
Maybe next year. But we were in one bar called Pop World. It was all right. Then we went to Cozy Joe's. And at no point did I think we were going to be there for the rest of the night. But it was that good. We stayed the rest of the night and it was epic. Had a brilliant night. And Stephen was up doing karaoke. I don't know why you chose the song, but it was Paul... Simon doing You Can Call Me Al. And do you know what? You had the crowd gone crazy. Loved
Listen,
it. They sang along with
pleaser.
You. It was a huge crowd pleaser. You did really, really well. And here is the big shock of the night. I, you and Cameron stayed out later than Stephen Mill.
That is actually true. That's what happened.
He went to his bed earlier than me because he was gone.
I had to go downstairs to go to the toilet because it was a long, winding one of those ones.
Yeah, you couldn't be arsed coming back up.
I couldn't be arsed coming back up the stairs, and I went, I've had enough, and I just went home.
Yes, you did.
And that was it. But there was another thing, another big development from the weekend. I taught you a new card game.
It's one of the best card games I've ever played. We played it going down to Newcastle, and we played it coming back up from Newcastle. What was it called again?
Seven of Diamonds.
Seven of Diamonds. Brilliant game. Absolutely thoroughly
enjoyed
it.
How many games did you win out the probably 20 that we played you in?
Three. I won three.
You won one.
No, you're a liar.
You won one. You won one, Ewan.
Okay, I won one.
Yeah.
Last thing I'm going to say about Newcastle, we were standing on the platform yesterday, come back up the road, and a boy approaches us from Scotland. I think it was from Dundee.
Mm-hmm.
So Dundee, wasn't he?
You spoke to him more than I did.
And he said, love the podcast, listens to it every single week, and he wants me to cut out the movie reviews.
Yeah.
And he was with a young lady, so I hope I'm not dropping him in it.
Right.
Well, I won't name him, just in case.
Did you get his name?
No.
Right,
did
well,
you
can't name him then. If
did you?
No.
Because I thought you got his name because he approached you first.
He did, yeah.
Tall guy.
Yeah, very
huge.
Tall. He had a sort of like Paul Weller haircut.
You know, that sort of like...
Trying to be something he's no. Try to be cool. Do you think he suited it?
I think he looked cool, yeah.
And I actually thought he was punching because right. She was lovely.
I spoke to her as well,
but he was trying to be 10 years younger than he was and it wasn't working.
Right, okay.
You know who you are because we met you on the platform at Newcastle. So he says, oh, I don't want any more movie reviews. Well, I'm not going to give you a movie review today. I'm going to give you another review, which is a TV documentary. Would you give me my music? I think there will be people listening to this podcast that will have been involved in this. It's a fantastic documentary on Netflix. It's called Ashley Madison, Sex, Lies and Scandal.
Is this the affair website?
So this is a website which was for married people mm-hmm. to have secret affairs, but they didn't want to lose their wife, their husbands and their family. They just wanted something on the side where they could have a bit of fun and keep that excitement going. 40 million people signed up to Ashley Madison in like a 5-year period. They were making on average $250,000 a day. And then in 2015, somebody hacked into it and released every single name and all the details of every single person that was on that website, and including pictures, their sexual preferences, etc., etc., etc. It tells the story of what happened, how it was hacked, and also people who were marriages ended because of it. So
well,
people step forward.
So yes.
So I would highly recommend it. It's 3 episodes. It's on Netflix. It just dropped there last week. Ashley Madison, Sex, Lies and Scandal. And there's no doubt about it. There are people in Scotland who got involved in that and got caught out with that. But they don't name anybody for Scotland.
Right.
I mean, okay. There's 40 million people, but there's a few that tell their story. We're talking about some high power lawyers, famous people.
I would imagine so,
sports
yeah.
people. It was just YouTubers.
Radio presenters.
I'm sure there was. Mm. But not me. Not this boy.
Not me.
Not you either.
No.
I don't think there's... But do you know of anyone who was on Ashley Madison back in the day?
No, I don't.
Are you aware of anyone, Producer John, that might have been on Ashley Madison?
Not that I know of. But what was that website again, just for clarity? AshleyMadison.co.uk.
.com, I think. Is it still going? Is it still a thing?
Is that... Just go and check that, mate. I don't know if it's still a thing. Can you? But there's
a
thing.
I can't because it'll be in my Google searches. What if my wife
does? No, but you do it for research purposes.
Right, okay. Ashley
Madison. But here's the thing, though. 40 million people signed. Think about that for a second. 40 million married people signed up to that to have an affair.
Yeah, but think how many people there are in the world.
But think about that. 40 million people wanted to have an affair.
It's still on the go.
Is it still on the go?
7 billion people in the world.
Oh, it's a bit sexy, this, isn't it? Life is short. Have an affair. That's the tagline.
That's the tagline. It is. But I recommend it. It's a really good documentary about how they started up the business. And one of the executives.
Who is Ashley Madison?
Ashley Madison at the time were the two most popular names in America.
Right. Okay.
Ashley Madison. So they called Ashley Madison. And here's the best quote. One of the executives, one of the main sales guys for Ashley Madison, when he was at a convention, somebody said to him, "Who's your biggest competitor?" And he went, "The Bible." What a line that is.
Great.
Watch it. It's very, very good. Okay, and I wonder if the boy we met in Newcastle had met... He's Ashley Madison.
We don't want to suit here, Ewen.
No. We're not naming names. He was with a lovely young lady. I don't know whether they're together.
The guy was perfectly nice. Why are you being an arsehole?
No, I don't know if it was like an Ashley Madison hookup or not.
You're being an arsehole. Stop it.
Yeah, no, but...
The guy was perfectly pleasant.
He was nice. Lovely.
So what?
No, here's the thing, though. If he had met somebody for a hookup in Newcastle, he wouldn't have approached us.
Why?
Because we're in the radio.
So?
You wouldn't have... If I was having an affair, I'm not approaching somebody that is famous.
Even if... Well, I don't think we're... But you... Like...
No, but if you're in the public eye...
Even if that was the case... He probably wouldn't bank on you being an arsehole and talking about it.
Yeah, no, but I don't know. I'm not saying he did. I'm just saying I wonder, I mean...
I'm sure everything was above board. He was a very nice man.
He was lovely.
Right.
Although he looked a wee bit like Paul Weller.
Let's move on to some correspondence and a couple of nice reviews as well from last week's episode. On the quiz, Key McLeod. Ewen could have had a quiz about his close family and still not won. Specialist in failure, as Mourinho said. Ben says, Jambo Bear screwed in the quiz again. Stephen said, 6... for Dunfermline's top scorer, but John said it was 7 20 seconds later. Conspiracy continues.
Great shout.
However, Benz, as I think I even replied to him on Twitter, the question was not, how many goals has Dunfermline's top scorer scored this season. It was how many goals has Craig Whiting scored this season, which was 6, which was the correct answer. And Dunfermline's top scorer.
Producer John, did you specifically say Craig Whiting?
Craig Whiting, yeah.
Craig Whiting.
Absolutely.
And Dunfermline's top goal scorer is Lewis McCann, who has 7.
Okay.
That's when it went on to, you know, Dunfermline.
I appreciate that people out there are looking out for me, so I appreciate that, my man. You might have got that one wrong, though.
No, he has definitely got it wrong. Hey, wee Scotch guy says, I've come to the conclusion that Ewan has never learned anything in his life. I mean, it's hard to disagree with that.
I learned how to use a BD and I miss it.
Yeah. Lots of chat about my opinion on Celtic and Rangers and the records last week as well. I got quite a few messages about that. Bears 84 says, only two fans outside the Old Firm would say that Europe is above breaking each other's records. Silly comment.
I don't think it's a silly comment at all.
Andy Taker says, this is quite a long one, but basically, sorry, but I cannot agree with Stephen Lee's point about Europe versus domestic success. As a Rangers fan, I've now seen us win the league in both cups, with the League Cup being the last one I had to wait for. What to wait to get us the European final, blah, 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 blah. European nights will live forever, blah, 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 blah. We should have won at least one more League Cup and another Scottish Cup in the last 5-10 years. Domestically, we should be doing a lot better. That's the sort of the gist of that. So yes. Graham says, domestic bragging is all we have in Scotland, and to be fair, most countries our size in Europe. Rangers did well getting to Europa League final, but that's a once in a generation type achievement. Will I Am says, as a Celtic fan, these are just numbers in history books. The here and now is what matters. Continuation of a recent domination and being the best at the end of each season is the be all and end all. Dave said, what does doing well in Europe mean, though? Think Rangers have done a decent job there over the last 6 years, bar last season. Rangers need to concentrate more on trying to win the league titles back again. And Donny says, you know, it annoyed me when I first heard this. Then I took a thought and took a breath. And Stephen is right. Scottish football is turning into a backwater of a sport, according to Donny. So that caused quite the...
It caused quite the debate.
Yeah, and that's fine.
And that's what it's about. It's about having an opinion. You believe in one thing, we believe in another, and that's why we love football.
Exactly.
Because we all have different opinions.
Colin Todd says, thanks to this podcast, Jose Katongo was in my dream the other night. He was helping me buy a bathroom in Bunnings, which is the Aussie equivalent of B&Q. He even managed to get me a deal on the tiles I wanted by showing me how to steal them and not get caught. So thanks for that. That's Colin, the biggest Pars fan in Western Australia. Thanks very much for listening, Colin. And Dave Trump says, was that Pat Mustard at Ewan's door last week? Remember your ring doorbell went? And if you'd watched Father Ted, you'd know who Pat Mustard is. So there we are. Thank you very much for your comments. Just a few other wee bits from the week. Derek McInnes won the Football Writers Manager of the Year. Lauren Shankland won the Player of the Year.
Correct.
Darren Young was sacked by Stirling Albion after their relegation back to League Two. Only one season in League One. And Celtic women's team won their first SWPL title on goal difference after beating Hibs 1-0 despite Rangers winning 4-0 against Partick Thistle yesterday. That was who the title was between.
Went to the wire,
and it was a late goal for Celtic, so they have won the SWPL. Congratulations to them. Right, let's move on to the football now. I'll go through the scores and all the rest of it. I'm not going to spend too much time talking about the matches.
Do we need to talk about the games?
Because most of them don't actually mean anything. Celtic 3, St Mirren 2. Obviously, I thought St Mirren played pretty well from what I saw. And I guess the big talking point from that is Santa brought out the trophy.
Can I just say, genius. Genius.
Now, this is obviously Santa's downtime of the year. Like, he's not particularly busy at this time, but he crams a lot in over the Christmas period.
But just before Christmas, he would have been upset at the booing that he got at Celtic
Park.
There
was an amazing bit of commentary on Sports Scene. I don't know if you saw it. It was Liam McLeod. And he was describing, like, oh, here's Santa bringing out the trophy. And he was like, and of course, Santa was abused by the fans.
Abused.
Earlier on this season. Which made me laugh out loud. So,
but do you know what? I think only in Scottish football would that happen. You wouldn't see that anywhere else. And that's why it's unique and it's different. Yes, we can moan and grumble and complain about how we live in this goldfish bowl and it's all about my dad's bigger than your dad and some of the pathetic debates that we get into and we fall out over. But see that. That was just genius. That was such a good laugh. We were in the studio. All of us in the studio just pissed ourselves off.
I was like, ah, fair enough. Aye, fair
Santa
enough.
Stood in the tunnel with the trophy.
That was quite good, yeah. So yeah, Celtic made heavy weather of it. Some men played pretty well. Mark O'Hara getting a couple of goals for...
He should have had a hat trick.
Yep, he should have. But Celtic won 3-2, so picking up the trophy on the back of a win. A thriller at Tynecastle. Hearts 3, Rangers 3, Shankland on the score sheet again. A great equaliser from Tagawa. McCausland, Cantwell and Silva getting goals for Rangers in the meantime. So that means that Hearts end the season 17 points behind Rangers. And Rangers are 8 points off Celtic as well. So
they're in a worse position than when Clement came in?
Pretty much, yes.
They've had an absolute shite month of May and April.
Rangers head into the cup final conceding 7 goals in the last 3 matches. So
they've had such a poor end to the campaign. I mean, it was there for them. It was in their hands.
I mean, it doesn't really matter. It was done on Saturday anyway.
Yeah. And well, last Saturday.
Last Saturday. So Dundee won, Kilmarnock won, rounding off the top 6 on Saturday. So, that was the 4th time this season that they've drawn. Dundee and Kilmarnock drew all their games.
Can we spend at least a minute or so on Lauren Shanklin scoring 31 goals in a Scottish football season?
Yeah, well, I mean, to be fair.
Play my tune. Would you? White camera. Happy dance for Shanklin again. White camera.
H-E-A-R-T-S. If you can't spell it, then here's what it says.
S-H-A-N-K. Land.
Shanklin. 31 goals. Congratulations.
Thank you.
What a season for him. And
go and clip that up and send it to Lawrence for me, mate.
He will be on the plane at the Euros. We'll chat about that very shortly as well, because the squad announcement is this week. Dundee 1, Kilmarnock 1. Bottom 6, the only thing that was to be decided was who was going to be in the relegation playoff. And fair play to St Johnston. They came from behind. They were 2 points behind Ross County going into yesterday's matches. Ross County drawing at home to Aberdeen 2-2, and obviously St Johnston beating Motherwell by 2-1. Nicky Clark, Sidibe getting the goals, and it just goes to show you Ross County getting absolutely pumped by Motherwell.
Aye.
The goals. Because they are in the relegation playoff via goal difference. St Johnston minus 25, Ross County minus 29.
I don't want to upset Raith Rovers fans here. I don't mean to upset you, but I'm going to upset you. And the reason I'm going to upset you is this. I much prefer that Ross County are playing against Raith Rovers than St Johnston, because I think Raith Rovers would have had a better chance against St Johnston. I think it'll be a harder game against Ross County. And the reason I don't want Raith Rovers anywhere near the top flight of Scottish football, they've just got rid of one plastic pitch. I don't want another one coming up. Because so that's what would happen if Raith Rovers win the playoff.
You'd prefer Ross County in the Premiership over Raith Rovers?
Yes, because I don't want a plastic pitch. What have I done? What have I done for the last 3 seasons?
I know, but leaving that aside, do you not think that Raith Rovers have a cracking season, finish second?
Don't give a shit.
Squeak through on Friday night, I think they'll admit that. But you
rip up your plastic pitch, put a grass pitch down, I'll welcome you with open arms. I can't even not.
Is that your red line? Even though like Raith Rovers traditionally, a proper football club and all
red
the rest
line,
of it.
Red line. Red line all the way through it. Listen, I can't. I've got to be consistent. I've given
Livingston. You wouldn't like to see Falkirk back in the top flight then?
Again, when Falkirk get to that position, I don't want to see them there unless they get a grass pitch.
This is ridiculous. What have we seen this season?
Who's asked for your opinion?
No, but you've mentioned. I'm sitting here.
You're a Falkirk fan who's going to sit there and greet and scream about, oh, but the plastic pitch, and that's what we have, and it's good for the community, etc., etc., etc. I get all that, but see, at the end of the day, Scottish football, the Premiership, the Premier League, whatever you want to call it, is what we sell to the world.
Right.
Plastic pitches, that one at Kilmarnock, a disgrace. Livingston, a disgrace. Raith Rovers, Falkirk, plastic pitches have no place. In Scottish
nonsense.
Football.
In absolute no play.
There's
nonsense
a reason why Holland have banned them from the top flight of the Eredivisie. For the very same reason that I bang on about the plastic pitches in Scotland. You cannot have that in the top flight of your domestic game. End of story. You will never see it in the Premiership. You'll never see it in Italy. Holland have just banned it. You'll not see it in any of the top leagues in Europe. Let's get away from that.
There should be no... like ban, outright ban on plastic pitches. There should be a, now this is where we'll agree, Ewan, there should be a quality check and there should be a certain level. Falkirk have just relayed their pitch at a massive cost, right? And it's top quality. It's the top.
It's what, plastic.
Like, what do Rangers and Celtic train on? What do Rangers and Celtic train on during the week, Ewan?
Stephen.
What do Rangers and Celtic train on during the week?
John, it's quality. It's those little rubber bobble things. It's like little pellets that bounce up. And see when the ball gets kicked by the goalkeeper and it bounces. It's like these
little. Ewan, you talked about the quality of Airdrie's pitch. When Hearts played Airdrie in the cup, you said it was really good for, that was a really good pitch.
For a plastic pitch.
And I think Shelley Kerr was on as well and said the exact same thing.
But then I
so
got
how on, should, wait, then wait, let's go to Dundee then, shall we? Let's go to Motherwell.
Go shut him up.
Let's go to Celtic.
Go and shut him up.
You know
you
what I mean?
Started
you started it.
Right,
exactly.
Shelley Kerr, who we phoned after that game against Airdrie, and we did say, look, that looked like a half-decent plastic pitch, and they actually made reference to it when they were doing the game between Airdrie and Hearts. But when I got Shelley Kerr on speakerphone talking about that game, she said, yes, it's a good pitch, but yes, we'd prefer grass.
Right, so you think whoever ends up, so let's just say Raith Rovers do get promoted or down this season after this vote, whoever ends up top of the Championship, wins the league, and just say they have a plastic pitch and they have to relay it at the cost of 1.8 million. You say they shouldn't come up.
They kind of come up.
Joke. Absolute joke.
Well, you've got nothing to worry about, mate. She ain't coming up next season anyway, so shut your face.
I mean, to be fair, Falkirk obviously have a history of playing in shitholes and not being able to get promoted as well. So,
this is
I
what
mean,
I'm coming back to. Yeah. It's an absolute joke.
Shut up.
Yeah, well, I mean... Listen, the rules are what they are at the moment.
They'll change them.
There doesn't seem to be too much of it. Well,
I'm telling you, they'll change it.
It wasn't on the agenda.
No, they scrapped it because they're having A paper has been put forward.
By
Ray. I am telling you right now, when it is discussed and a decision is made, plastic pitches in the top flight of Scottish football will not be allowed.
Of course it will, because everyone, the Rangers and Celtic and all these clubs will vote on it.
And it'll be the right decision. So if Falkirk were to win the league next year and you've got a plastic pitch, you ain't getting in with the big boys unless you lay down
the
grass.
So you think, so we've seen Airdrie, right? Airdrie went bust, right? Absolute bust, because they had to build a 10,000-seater stadium. A lot of other clubs went into real trouble.
Motherwell,
and administration.
I'm aware of all
this. Yes, they all went into trouble. So you think that clubs up and down the country should be sacrificed because of plastic pitch, because Rangers, Celtic, Hearts, Aberdeen say that this community provincial clubs,
Stephen, go do me a favour. Do you want to go and give him some oxygen? He's hyperventilating
here's what I think, right? If Raith Rovers end up beating Ross County over the two legs, they'll deserve to come up, obviously, to the Premiership, regardless of what they're playing on. So they should be allowed to play next season in the Premiership. There's no doubt about that. However, if Falkirk do win the league next season, I think we should ban plastic pitches from the top flight. And I think that's the only fair way to do it, I think. Yeah.
Make sure it's in place for next year.
Here's a few stats from the Premiership season. We're going to rate every single team, by the way, in the Scottish Premiership out of 10. We'll get to that in just a wee second, but there's a few stats that I've seen flying around. Thanks to Pye and Bovril on Twitter for some of these as well. Another one. There were no hat-tricks scored in the Scottish Premiership this season.
That.
The first season in the Scottish top flight history since 1890 without one, which is ludicrous. That's ludicrous.
And Mark O'Hara was a post away from getting a hat-trick at the weekend against Celtic.
So that's the start of the week. SPFL Premiership penalties received. Do you know who's top of the table for that?
That'll be close between Rangers and Celtic. Rangers, though.
Rangers 16.
Celtic 15?
16 for Celtic. Same amount of penalties as Rangers. Then St Mirren, Hearts, Livingston, Motherwell, Dundee, Aberdeen, Hibs, Kilmarnock, St Johnstone, Ross County only with one penalty this season. Most penalties conceded this season. Do you want to know who's at the bottom of these lists?
Celtic and Rangers.
Rangers 4, Celtic 3, top of the list. Aberdeen conceded 12 penalties this season. Dundee 11, Hibs 10, Hearts 8, Motherwell 8, St Johnstone 8, St Mirren 8, Livingston, Ross County 7, and Kilmarnock 6.
What did Celtic and Rangers concede?
Rangers conceded 4 penalties and Celtic conceded 3.
I suppose they spend most of the time in our half anyway.
Conceded. The crime count. So who were the dirtiest team in the Scottish Premiership if you're getting 1 point for a yellow card and 2 points for a red card? Who do you think?
The dirtiest team in the Premier League? That's a really good question. I would probably go with somebody near the bottom. I would go probably... Actually, I'll go Livingston.
Livingston, actually, were mid-table.
Were they?
Only got 76
Are they points. In the top six or the bottom six?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 They're in the top six.
Dundee?
Dundee, fifth.
Hearts? Nah.
Nah. It's Ross County.
Is it? Dirtiest team.
Just ahead of Kilmarnock. Do you want to guess who's at the bottom of this list in terms of...
Celtic and Rangers.
Celtic and Rangers are at the bottom of the list. Yeah, funny that. I mean, because we always hear that referees are against them, but never mind. We'll get to the teams in just a wee second in terms of the 10 out of 10. Let me quickly speak about the playoffs, though. Obviously, Raith Rovers, as we've mentioned, made it through on Friday night against Partick Thistle after penalties.
Well, they were lucky. Brian Graham's chance at the end.
Brian Graham...
he's got nightmares about that.
Absolutely. So it was literally last kick of the ball. Yeah. Would have put them through. And, also the... The Partick Thistle keeper should have saved about four of the penalties.
But he got near them all. I think apart from one, he went to the right side.
And even the last one, Lewis Vaughan, it was a terrible penalty.
In the middle.
He parried it into the net. Yeah. So there we are. Raith Rovers through, and they will play Ross County for a place in the Premiership next season. First leg is Thursday night, 8 o'clock kickoff. At Starts Park, live on Sky. And then Sunday, 12 noon, Ross County versus Raith Rovers. Again, live on Sky with that one. Congratulations to Dumbarton, who are heading to League One. Michael Ruth with a double. And Spartans denied a double promotion. And Dougie Samuel leaving as Spartans manager. That was his final game, so he couldn't go out with a win. But Spartans will be delighted with their season, obviously, getting to the final of the playoffs. Stranraer got past East Kilbride 3-1. Who's this?
George Bowie.
Okay. Just answer it.
George, you're on the podcast.
I'm on the what?
You're on the podcast, the big Scottish football podcast.
All right, so don't swear.
No, well, you can, it's allowed. But the reason that we're phoning you, producer John revealed to us on the podcast a few minutes ago that you, my friend, might be the only person in Scotland that we know that has a bidet in the bathroom.
Yes, and I'll tell you what happened. It was in the house when I bought it, by the way. So don't think for a minute that I got a bidet installed when I bought the house. It came. So I wanted at least a grand knocked off the asking price to accept the bidet, knowing that I'd be roundly criticised by my colleagues for this. But one time, Clyde, you were there. Remember we all went out in the West End for a party and we all went back to mine afterwards?
Yes.
And do you know how girls go to the toilet together?
Yes.
Cassie and Amber went to the toilet together, and Cassie had obviously had a wee drink, so didn't realise what was going on until she turned around when she heard Amber say, "Do you know, I think it's really weird that George and Ellen have got two toilets side by side?"
And one of them doesn't have a toilet seat.
That is not a toilet. That's a bidet. Well, what's a bidet? I don't know if she turned on the hose and showed her, but... I've never used it, the reason I was
phoning you, mate, because I was used to using a BD when I lived in the Middle East. Can I come round and borrow it sometime?
Anytime you want it. There's what's mine is yours, mate. You know that.
Oh, I love you, man. Thanks for that.
Don't bring Stephen.
Cheers, Georgie.
Hey guys.
Bye, mate. Bye. There you go. George Bowie with a BD.
With a BD. There we are. Glad that's clarified. Stranraer 3, East Kilbride 1. And you might have heard the commentary from over the weekend from Stranraer's victorious match against East Kilbride. I mean, Stranraer are staying up. And it was a couple of goals in extra time that actually led it to it. And the Stranraer commentators were absolutely loving it.
And Stranraer stay in League 2. Stranraer stay in League 2, and can I say, John Hannah, Muriel Gray, Ali McCoist, Lorraine Kelly, Wally's Roundabout, Kirsty Young, your boys took a half a beating.
So congratulations to Stranraer.
Had he had a few drinks during the game?
No, I just think they're like that. They're like that. They
sound like they had a few drinks.
Yeah, so congratulations, Stranraer. East Kilbride.
Roundabout did he mention there?
The Whirly's Roundabout in East Kilbride. There's millions of roundabouts in East Kilbride. So, yes, we'll see what happens over the next few weeks. As I mentioned last week, East Kilbride might have another wee reprieve. We'll just leave it at that. Inverness relegated to League One.
Shocker, isn't it?
So, Hamilton winning 3-2 on the day at Inverness. Kevin O'Hara, a couple of goals.
goals. And yeah, it means that Hamilton bounced straight back from relegation from the Championship last season to win promotion against Inverness. Inverness have been in the, you know, was it? It's been a wee while since they've been in the Premiership.
Has there been any chat around Ferguson's job?
I would imagine.
Have you seen anything? I'm not seen or heard anything.
The Inverness Supporters Trust released a statement criticising the board and the management, as you'd expect as well. I was reading earlier on one of the podcasts that they've got, Inverness Podcast, also calling for Ferguson to go. I think there is money bother at Inverness as well. Things are not good at Inverness and financial-wise.
So the last thing they needed was to go into League One?
The absolute last thing that they needed. So there's a few rumours flying about Inverness, but, you know, we'll just need to wait and see what happens over the next wee while. Right, we're going to ditch VAR.
I don't care for it because nobody cares,
John. So what we're going to do is we are going to rate all of the Premiership teams out of 10 this season. So here we go. Out of 10... we'll start
start at the bottom.
We'll start with Livingston, obviously relegated. Out of 10, Ewen Cameron, Livingston.
One. Yeah.
I'm surprised you're even giving them one.
I gave them something. Right. They turned up.
For turning up. Right, let's move on to Ross County then, out of 10.
They surprised me at how poor they were this year. So I'm going to give them a 3.
Three for Ross County. By the way, I'm going to give Livingston a... I'm going to give Livingston a 2. Okay. I'm going to give them a 2. I'm going to give Ross County a 2.
Okay.
Because I think they have really underachieved. For the money that they'll be spending on that squad, I think they've underachieved. Mm. They also appointed Derek Adams, which they lose points for. St Johnston!
They are actually, even though they've just avoided the playoffs, they've been shocking this year. They've been poor to watch. They don't score goals.
But we did say, you had them in the relegation playoff. I had them down to get relegated.
I had Ross County in the playoffs.
Oh, did you?
Aye, right, okay. So I got that. But what I'm saying is, St Johnston can't score goals. They're crap to watch. They're below Ross County for me. They get a two. They're so bad. They are pish beyond belief.
I'm actually going to give St Johnston a 4.
Mate,
the reason
I can't justify it. Nearly halfway.
I'm going to give them a 4 because.
Did you watch them?
I'm not. That's not just the criteria. I don't disagree. Of course it is, but it's part of it. The reason I'm going to give them a 4 is because I thought they were going to get relegated. And they've actually...
Oh, because they've proved you wrong. So you think they deserve a wee bit more credit for that.
And also, I thought they looked dead and buried for that relegation playoff spot, and they managed to get out of it with a great win yesterday. So I'm going to give St Johnston a 4.
No,
a
2 for me.
Right, Motherwell.
I expected more from them. I actually liked Motherwell, and I thought they were unlucky.
Somebody on this podcast suggested they might finish 3rd.
Well, Stephen, I don't think you're that far off because of the amount of draws that they've got in the league campaign. They've won the same amount of games as Dundee this season. It was the draws that killed them. Motherwell for me were entertaining. Blair Spittle, brilliant. Theo Bear up top, brilliant. I think they've had a good season. I know it's not the league position they would have wanted to finish in. I thought they just had a really unlucky campaign. For me, I'm going a 5.
A 5 for Motherwell?
Yeah, I think they've been a good watch. I think they've been good games involving them. I've enjoyed Motherwell this year.
Okay, I'm going to go a 4 for Motherwell.
They've been a good watch, Stephen.
I think they've underachieved.
Do you think they've underachieved?
Absolutely.
I'd call it unlucky.
Okay, right. Hibs.
One for Hibs. For a club the size of Hibernian, that is an absolute shocker. They
finishing 8th on 46 points, won 11, shocker. Drawn 13, lost 14.
Shocker there with Livingston with me on one. That was, I mean, terrible. The kind of players that they've got and the investment they put into that squad in January.
I'm going to give Hibs a 1 as well. Aberdeen finishing 7th on 48 points.
They get a 2 from me. Again, they've underachieved. I thought they were poor, but Miofsky is an absolute star of a player. But
they're unbeaten in the last 8 or 9 matches.
Yeah, and that's why they get a 2.
Right, okay. I'm going to give Aberdeen a 3. Because I think that they should deserve a wee bit of credit for their wee run. They also got to what?
League Cup final.
They also got to a semi-final of the Scottish Cup.
And we're lucky in that.
And we're a wee bit unlucky. And I also think that they actually had a good go in Europe. A couple of decent results in Europe.
I think overall, we're talking about the league campaign, they cannot be in the bottom six.
Okay, right. Dundee, what are we going for? Finishing sixth on 42 points.
I didn't agree that Tony Dock should be in the running for manager of the year. They won 10 games.
Right, okay.
They won 10 games. Listen, I'm going to give them some credit because they're a newly promoted team and to finish in the top six is great. But for me, overall, they're getting a four.
Right, so just to clarify.
They're getting a four.
You're giving Motherwell a five for finishing ninth.
Yeah.
And you're giving Dundee a four, despite the fact they're newly promoted.
Yeah.
And going at the top six.
Yeah.
I'm going to give Dundee a seven.
They won the same amount of games
as
Motherwell.
Doesn't matter. The last five games were against all the harder teams.
Motherwell were a better watch.
Yeah, I mean, Motherwell were playing the bottom six.
Just, I'm just talking generally over the season.
Yeah. I'm going to give Dundee a seven. Because
Seven.
Because I think coming up...
They won 10 games.
It doesn't matter.
That was out of 38.
Right, but Motherwell had played dross teams for the last five games and Dundee played the hard teams.
Played hard games.
So I'm going to give Dundee a seven. I think...
Seven.
I think Tony Docherty's done a good job. And I think to getting in the top six, first season after getting promoted... is a big achievement. So
I'm not just handing out points willy-nilly
here. Right, St Mirren.
Well, I've been impressed.
Finishing fifth with 47 points in Europe for the first time in, you know,
and I'm
ages.
I'm a huge fan of Stephen Robinson and I'm pals with...
You're pals, man.
You can't even remember his name. You're a pal. He's your pal, you know.
I went to the cup game with him.
Ah, he's your pal, exactly. Your big pal for St Mirren. What's his name, though?
Jamie Langfield. So, I think Stephen Robinson is going to be a wanted man this summer. I think he's done a fantastic job. They're getting a strong 7+ for me.
7.5. Where we go? We'll go 7.5.
Aye.
Okay. I'm going to give St Mirren an 8 because I think it's been a cracking season. I totally agree with you. I think Stephen Robinson's done a great job.
Brilliant job.
8 out of 10 for me. You couldn't really ask for much more than that. The only reason I'm probably not giving them a 9 is because I'm going to give Kilmarnock a 9 out of 10.
They get an 8 from me.
An 8 for you and Cameron, because again, I think that...
They lose a point for their plastic pitch.
Right, okay. I think Kilmarnock and Derek McInnes, brilliant, done such a good job over the course of the season, and fully deserved 9 for me, 8 for you and Cameron. Heart of Midlothian, finishing 3rd on 68 points.
An 8.
8?
I think the football hasn't been great.
Ah, here we go. It's starting already, isn't it? This is it starting.
What?
You're just going to keep moaning about, like, it doesn't matter. It'll be, oh, we don't care about the results anymore. The football's garbage. This is how it got under Robbie Nielsen as well. Robbie Nielsen was consistently finishing 3rd in the league, but you were like, oh, the football's rubbish to watch. I can't watch it.
But
even though we keep winning all the time.
I have been... I have been encouraged that in the last couple of games we've gone a 4-2-3-1 and we've been more of a threat, and I thought we were very good against Rangers in a game that meant nothing. I understand that, but I'd like to see us continue in a 4-2-3-1 formation, especially with the players we've just brought in. So Hearts getting 8 for me.
Okay,
good
I'm
season.
Going an 8 for Hearts as well.
Good.
I agree. I think Hearts have had a good season. Stephen Naismith has done a pretty decent job winning 20 games this season as well, which is pretty impressive. And I think it's their second or third highest points total this century.
And we've only lost 3 more games than Rangers. That just puts into context.
Let's get to Rangers then. Second on 85 points.
This is a tough one, this, because I was impressed with Clement when he first walked through the door.
They've won the League Cup. They're in a Scottish Cup final.
I know that. And he galvanised that squad. And then they had the destiny of the league title in their own hands. And then they blew it. And then some of his decisions towards the end of the campaign and his substitutions and his team lineups were quite baffling. It's been a mixed season for them. I'm going to give them a 7.
A
7 for Rangers.
I'm going to give Rangers a 6 because, yeah, they've won the League Cup. They might still win the Scottish Cup, in which case I would give them more than a 6. But,
yeah, I get you.
Ultimately, they're still miles behind Celtic. They
haven't. Not this season, they're not.
Well, they haven't beaten Celtic this season for the first time since 2017.
Over a 38-game season, I wouldn't say they're miles off, because I think Celtic haven't been great either.
Well, we'll get to that in just a wee second, yeah, in terms of what we're going to give them.
Yeah.
But I think that it's a pretty poor Rangers team. I think there's big changes needed in the summer. I think there's a lot of players there that need to bin.
Yes.
I don't know how they're going to fund it, because they need to...
Butland will fund it.
I know, but again, Butland has been their best player this season by a mile. So I think that that's... You don't want to lose your best players. If you're Rangers, you want to be holding on the guys like Butland.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, they'll probably have to sell them.
It's a bit like Celtic. You'd like them to keep the likes of Jota and Edward and Dembele, but if big money comes in, you're going to let it go so you can rebuild.
Just like you said, Rangers had the destiny of the title in their hands, but when it came to the crunch,
yeah,
again...
Bottled it.
The players were found wanting against Ross County,
and Dundee,
who are in the relegation playoff.
And Dundee.
And Dundee, who you just said had a rotten season. So it's six for me, seven for Ewan. And finally, Celtic finishing first, 93 points. What are you reckoning?
Again, a bit like Rangers, I don't think they were particularly great. Although, can I just say, the last six games, Celtic were starting to motor and play some really attractive
25
stuff.
25 points out the last 27.
But the football was just getting better and better and better and better, and O'Reilly just came onto a game. But for the over the course of the season, I don't think Celtic were that great. So they get an 8 from me.
Okay, and they get an 8 from me as well. So that is an 8 and an 8 for me. I completely agree with you. I don't think it's a vintage Celtic team at all.
But it's scary how good they became towards the end.
They've been, obviously the last like 10 games or so, they have played very well. Yeah. But I think, yeah, an 8 for me, I think that's fair. And obviously if they win the Scottish Cup, that will be a cracking season.
Yes.
Winning a Cup double, so or a League and Cup double, I should say. So there we are. There's our 10 out of 10 for the Scottish Premiership. So just looking down, Ewan, you've given 8s to Celtic, Hearts, Kilmarnock. So that's your top scorers.
Top three.
For me, my top three are Kilmarnock on 9,
mm-hmm,
and then I've given 8s to St Mirren, Hearts and Celtic.
So that's your top?
That's my top 4. Three, aye. So there you are. Right, there we are, 10 out of 10. We'll do that again next season, if we're still here, you know.
What, do you think a bomb's going to drop or something?
They might get rid of us, you never know.
Do you think we'll
we might be put in the Scottish football bin?
Do you think that we'll live through the end of the world? Do you think there's a time? Do you think the world?
No, because if the world ends, we won't live through it.
No, do you think we'll live up to the end of the world and then we'll watch it happen?
No.
Do you think there's no chance of that happening?
No.
Because I watched what's that nuclear bomb movie thing?
Oppenheimer.
Yeah, it got you thinking, doesn't it? It gets you thinking.
Yeah.
That just one idiot presses a button.
I don't think it's as easy as that. Like, it's not just somebody wandering out like Homer Simpson, just going, "Oh, I wonder what that is," and then pressing it. I think there's a few stages you need to get to before that.
But you know the point I'm getting,
right?
Do you think we're as close now as we ever have been?
Well, probably yes. I mean, we're closer to the end of the world than what we are to the start. Probably. I don't know.
I was listening to a podcast with that boy. Who's that scientist guy?
Jamie Langfield.
No. Who's the guy that used to be in the band?
Professor Brian Cox.
He's brilliant. He's got a great voice.
Mm-hmm.
See, listen to him. He can make me fall asleep. He's got such a great voice. But I was listening to him. Do you know that in something like 90 million years' time, that Earth will no longer exist, that the sun will envelop us and destroy the planet?
Aye, but think how long 90 million years is.
But no, but
I mean, I think it's probably longer than that as well. I don't think it's 90 million years.
Is it a billion or something? But,
probably.
But it will. The Earth will one day not be here.
Yep.
We will all be just cosmic dust.
Yep.
Floating around the universe.
Yeah.
The Earth will disappear,
mm-hmm,
and will there be no trace of it? So I think we need to look at somewhere else to live.
Well, we've got 90 million years, or, you know, a few billion years, I would say, at least.
Producer John, can you Google that just for fact-checking? When will the sun eat the Earth?
I think there's a good 100 or so million years.
I'm not asking you to guess, mate. I'm not asking you to guess. I'm asking you fact-check this. See, when I listen to Joe Rogan, he has a guy called Jamie,
yes,
who sits there and he facts-checks stuff. So when we say something so we don't sound like idiots, fact-check it.
7.5 billion years.
Oh, before the sun eats us?
Yes.
Oh, okay then. So we're not going to worry about just now.
Yeah, I think we're all right.
I've got 5 billion.
All right. What did you Google?
I Googled, how long does the sun have left?
And that's the sun. I've typed in, when will the sun envelop the Earth?
Oh, right, but then the sun's going to die in 5 billion. But
yeah, it'll die away, yeah.
No, but it won't die away. It'll turn into a sort of red dwarf or something like
no,
that.
No, it'll turn into a planet, like a moon.
Aye, it'll be dead.
It'll be a dead planet, so you could land on
but
it.
But it'll still have a gravitational pull, which means that we'll just eventually crash into it.
Yes, there's that would happen as well. But you could land on the sun once the light goes out.
Aye, but we won't be able to do that because we'll be dead.
No, but
I don't mean me and you.
As a race, we could have moved to Mars, and then we can move to the
Why would
sun.
We move to Mars? Mars is already a dead planet.
Yeah, no, but if you build,
so that'd be a really stupid place.
But
to
if you
move.
Build the pods, if you watch some science fiction movies,
why would we move to Mars?
Because the Earth is going to be eaten by the sun, so we need to move somewhere.
Aye, but Mars would be a really shite place to move.
Yeah, no, but there's nowhere else nearer that you could. What else could you go to? I mean, you're not going to go to Saturn because Saturn.
It'd be like if you lived in Dunfermline and you were like, all right, we're going to move to Falkirk. You'd be like, well, why would you move to Falkirk? Falkirk's shite. You know what I mean?
Shut up.
It's just one of these things. Like, you'd move somewhere, like, if you lived in Dunfermline and you were like, oh, I'm going to move to New York, you'd be like, all right, fair enough. You're going to New York. Mm-hmm. But if you were like going to somewhere like this, you know.
Yeah, I know.
Not desirable.
Mean.
A dead
don't
planet.
Have kelpies.
Yeah.
Don't have a big wheel.
Aye.
Yeah. I think under Mars, there could be life. I think there might be a life and cities and stuff underneath Mars.
I doubt it.
And there's also talk that they could be under the water here on Earth.
Aye, like Atlantis. That'd be good. Right, anyway, shall we put something in the bin?
Get ready to open the big Scottish football trash can. It's in the bin.
Trash can. Okay, our version of Room 101 for Scottish football. We suggest something we want to see put in the bin. Last week, it was Mikey who wanted to put footballers who cut holes in their socks in the bin.
Great shout.
The results are in. Give me a drum roll, please, producer John. With 76.8% of the vote, they're going in the bin.
Well done, Mikey.
I think everyone agrees on that one.
Yeah.
Right. This week's nomination, we also have somebody on the line. Do we have...
Why are we getting punters to nominate stuff?
Because we've ran out. So, John, do we have Mark lined up?
He's there.
Mark the Gardener, a Hibs supporter. How are you doing, Mark?
I'm doing good, boys. How are you getting on?
Aye, good. Excellent.
A hip supporter. Oh, that's amazing.
You wouldn't have heard this bit yet because you weren't on the line, but we gave every single Scottish Premiership team a mark out of 10, Mark, and we both gave Hibs a 1 out of 10 for this season. Do you think that's fair?
Aye, it's quite generous, actually.
Who are you fancying for the new manager?
I'd like to give David Gray a shot. I don't know if it's too early, but I think...
Mate, stop. You've been a laughing stock for a couple of years now. Putting David Gray in that position, you'll become an even bigger laughing stock. He ain't got the experience.
Oh, you mean like Stephen Naismith? Like when he was in charge of the academy and he's come in and... How'd you finish third?
It's actually not a bad shout getting David Gray, actually.
Yeah, I mean, he's a legend, so, you know. Right, Mark, the gardener. What kind of gardener are you? Are you a landscape gardener, or are you going around and cutting old women's, like, lawns? What is it you do?
No, I work at a hotel. I'm the sort of head gardener there, so very much maintenance. Ongoing maintenance.
Excellent, that sounds class. Right, you'll be enjoying it over the next couple of months when you get a bit of decent weather as well, I suppose. What do you want to put in the Scottish football bin, Mark?
So, a pet hate of mine, football players, coaches, managers, when they cover their mouths while speaking to one another, it's just bonkers. I don't know why, I just find it very weird. And I think it's very much due to get sort of launched into the trash canister. Absolutely.
Aye. Yeah. Oh, I mean, like, I am fully behind you in this. We were even watching a game.
Yes,
we were. And I was like, how exciting are their conversations that they think that we can't reveal? I mean, probably they're just like, do you want a drink of juice or something like that? You know, like, it's probably absolute dross that they're talking anyway. So covering, and this has only come in over the last few years. It's gotten worse, though. Everybody does it now.
Do you know what I would suggest is probably happening there? is that when they're chatting away, I think they might be bad mouthing players in their team or the manager, and they don't want to get caught.
Nah. I think you'll get.
See that manager? He's a dickhead. I hate working with him. I hate playing for him. He's this and that. But I'm with you, my friend. This covering of the mouth needs to go in the Scottish football bin, so I think it's a great nomination.
It is not up to us, though. It's up to everyone else. So it's at Big Football Scott on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram as well. We will bring you the results next week on the podcast. For now, Hibs supporter Mark the Gardener, thank you very much for being in the Big Scottish Football Podcast.
Thanks, mate.
Thank you, Jumbo Bear. Cheers. Cheers. Right, OK, thank you, Mark. So players covering their mouth. When they're speaking to someone, maybe we should just do it for the rest of the podcast.
Do it like that for that. Yeah,
exactly. Sort of, I mean, I guess if you're just listening,
see that producer John, he's a prick.
If you're, I see John, I know I was slagging Falkirk off earlier on, but I mean, I really meant it.
Do you know when I was calling you a minger earlier?
Yeah,
he's stinking, man.
Oh, totally. Yeah, I could imagine.
Remember, I have control of your mic, so I can just cut you like that, and then we can't hear what you say. Hi, everyone. Welcome to the Big Scottish Football Podcast.
That's not fun for anyone. Yeah, exactly. Right, okay. Big Football Scott for the Scottish Football Bin, Mark the Gardener. Players covering them and managers covering their mouth and all the rest of it. Before we get on to a sort of quiz that you've got, Ewan, that you're going to explain in just a wee second, just want to speak very briefly about the Scotland squad announcement for Euro 2024. It's happening this Wednesday, two days from now. 26 players are going to be named. Who are we expecting? Any surprises? There's been a few rumours about maybe Elliot Anderson or
Connor Barron.
Like Connor Barron has been mentioned over the last wee while as well. It looks like, I mean, I think James Forrester wouldn't really be a surprise if he was in the squad, to be honest with you. I think he's going to be in it.
Hickey's definitely out. That's been confirmed.
Hickey is out. Yeah. So Nathan Patterson is out. Yeah. So that means they've got problems on the right-hand side. There's also an issue with the goalkeepers as well. Is he going to take Liam Kelly?
Will he take four keepers?
Will he take four keepers and take Craig Gordon as well? So I think it's between Craig Gordon and Liam Kelly.
Liam Kelly, yeah.
Because, I mean, I think Xander Clark and Angus Gunn are stick-ons.
Yeah.
So there's a wee issue there as well. Anyone else making a late run or anyone, any surprises? Do you think he'll have converted the likes of Harvey Barnes, perhaps, who I think scored for Newcastle yesterday?
But you would be raging if Harvey Barnes or an Elliot Anderson get jettisoned into.
Well, Elliot Anderson's a fullback, so I probably wouldn't be that upset with that, to be honest with you. Can he not play right back? Yeah, producer John, you're a Newcastle.
Elliot Anderson right back, no.
No, can he not?
No.
He's midfielder.
Midfielder or striker,
The thing is, though, there will be a lot of people who would be really pissed off.
I'm getting mixed up with the
Livramento. He's already said he wants to play
for England.
No chance.
But no, I think the big debate here is, will he take four goalkeepers? And if he doesn't, who does he drop?
Yeah,
because it'll be between Kelly and Gordon. Yeah,
exactly. So we'll see what happens over the next couple of days. Right, we have a quiz.
Yes,
before we get to the actual quiz, and it's called Hernan Crispo. So explain what it is for us, Ewan.
Right, Hernan Crispo is with this. You probably, if you're watching on YouTube, you will see there's some product placement.
There is some product placement. Yes. And could you tell us what the product placement is, Ewan?
Yeah, for those who are listening on Spotify and Apple Music and all that stuff, it is Scotty Brand's product placement.
So these are beetroot chips, Thai sweet chili flavour.
I've already had a bag, they're amazing.
Are they tremendous?
Well, I actually had a bag watching the football yesterday with a bottle of beer.
Right, okay,
so
fair enough.
Perfect for the Euros.
Yeah, at all. Yeah, I would imagine.
Because
so,
there's something about a Thai sweet chili flavour.
I do like
and a cold chili. Bottle of beer, and it just works brilliantly as a combination. So these are beetroot chips from Scotty Brand. And what we're going to do here, Stephen, hold on a wee second.
Right, because there's another one here.
There's another bag here. So you will win a bag of chips if you can name the three footballers that'll be appearing at the Euros.
Right, okay.
But you just need to listen to what I'm saying. Right. I'm going to be saying the player's name.
Okay.
And I'm going to have loads of crisps in my mouth.
Right, you're going to have loads of crisps in your mouth. Yeah. Okay, great. Are they Scottish players or it could be anyone?
Just Euro players.
Just Euro players.
They're really nice. Don't try one. No, you try one, you win it.
Yeah, if I win it, I'll try it, yeah.
Oh, so they are really good.
Stop eating them, Ewan, and just put them all in your mouth.
Yeah,
hold on.
That's how the game works.
Right, so you need to put like a whole bunch in your mouth.
The only thing that's missing here is a cold bottle of beer. Right.
Well, I mean, it's 12:20, so.
Right.
Don't make a mess. Please don't make a mess.
Why?
Because it's minging. Just put it all in your mouth. Put it in like a squirrel. Grotesque. Right. Player number one. Let's go. Do it again. Jakob something?
Mm-hmm.
Jakob.
Mm-hmm.
Sven Larsson. Jakob Sven Larsson. Is he a player? Is that who it is? Right. Is it the Jakob? I've got that bit right. Jakob, right?
There's three names.
Three names.
Yep. Larsson.
Is it Larsson?
Mm-hmm. The first name, second name. Hold on.
Jakob. Is it Jakob Sven Larsson?
Brun Larsson.
Brun Larsson. Jakob Brun Larsson.
Is this the radio?
Mm-hmm. Is this the radio? I got it right. Did I get it right?
I got it right. Give me a dinger from him.
All right, okay.
That is correct.
Okay, very good. Thank you. Right, so what was his name?
Jakob Brun Larsson.
Okay, and who does he play with?
Can't remember.
No, like...
I genuinely can't remember.
Because if he plays with Sweden, Sweden haven't qualified for the Euros.
No, it's definitely not Sweden. I think it's... Is he Danish or something? Oh, he's Danish.
He's Danish, right. Okay, that's
Danish,
right.
Okay, right, well okay. done. You need to get 2 out of 3 to win the crisps.
Right, okay, right. More crisps then.
Scotty brand potatoes. Love Scotty. I've worked with Scotty brand before with their potatoes. They're really good as well. Okay. Anyway, I need to put more crisps in my mouth. They're really nice.
So if I get this one, I win the baggy beetroot.
Right, you need to get this one right, though. Right, but we'll do all three.
Right, okay. I urge you to go on YouTube and watch this, because... This is... You're like a gremlin.
It was a good idea on paper.
Right, second one. Camavinga.
What's his first name?
I can't even mind his first name. What's
Ever Camavinga.
Ever. Camer. Flower. What's his name?
Edward.
Edward Camavinga. Yes, there we are. From France. There we are.
You've won the crisps. But I'm going to do the third one anyway, just for a laugh.
Right.
Oh my gosh, spat crisps everywhere. Have we got wet wipes in here to clean this up?
Right, just get on with the third one.
You won the crisp, I'll give them to you in a minute.
Right, okay.
Oh, this is a tough one. Right, you ready?
Yeah.
Here we go.
Yeah. Oh, Jesus, right. Laughed out loud. I don't know. Right, come on.
Raphael Lowe.
There it is. Right.
Laughed out loud.
There we go. You can get your Scotty brand beetroot chips for all your Euros needs over the summer. And Ewan, you don't have to eat them like Ewan did there, which was one of the most horrific things I've ever seen in my life. They're amazing. Get stuck into them. And and Ewan, you can go and get yourself cleaned up. Go and get yourself cleaned up. I'll speak to the people about a few other things.
Go on.
While you go and get cleared up.
for the last wee while. So, yes. So, check out Scotty Brand's new Thai sweet chili beetroot chips. And you and Cameron can... I mean, what a mess. What a mess. That was the first and last game of Hernan Crispo that I think we're ever going to have. So, there we are. Right, that's something...
Even European.
I know he's not European.
He's not even in Europe.
But that was very good. What was it? Was it Raphael Lau for the last?
Yeah. Right. Look, there's a picture of him if you're watching on YouTube.
Right, okay.
There he is.
Yeah, there's Raphael Lau. Yeah. Right, okay, fair enough. So there we are.
Really good though.
Thank you very much to Scotty Brand. and Ewen can get himself all cleared up there. So that's fine. Anyway, a wee reminder that Clyde on Super Scoreboard is on every single night this week from 6 p.m. taking your calls in the build up to the Scottish Cup final next weekend, which is obviously Celtic versus Rangers, and the boys will be on the air all the way through that on Saturday as well, live from Hampden. We'll be on the big Scottish football, the big Saturday football show, I should say.
Are we doing it this weekend?
4th 1, NORTHSOUND 1, MFR, West FM, and TFM. And of course, that is myself, Stephen Mill, alongside Ewen Cameron, and former Hibs and Aberdeen striker. Steve Cowan. So there we are. Right, let's move on to the quiz then, shall we? The actual quiz. The shootout quiz. So since the split and the big reset, Ewen Cameron has won precisely zero of those quizzes. So let's do it again today. And I believe, Producer John, we're getting the same questions again today. Is that correct?
Scottish Cup special.
A Scottish Cup special.
I came in this morning, I said, have you done your Father Ted research? No, I haven't. So you're both getting the same questions again today. And it's a Scottish Cup special.
Yay! Yay! Right, okay. So we need to write these down and then show them to the camera. That's how we're doing it, okay? And we'll for the benefit of people who are listening.
You've got a pen.
And not watching. You've got a pen there.
Yeah, I've got one.
Yeah, I've got a pen.
Okay. Right, go.
Right, oh, Producer John.
Right, we're ready to go. Right, we're going. Right, okay, gents. First question, what was the score in last year's Scottish Cup final? What was the score in last year's Scottish Cup final?
Do you want the teams?
No, just the score.
I'm going to give you the teams. Can I get a bonus point for that?
No.
Okay. You ready?
Yep.
Ready, okay. Both ready. Okay.
3-2-1.
3-1 Steven. To Celtic.
No, it was 2-1.
It was 3-1.
One of you is right.
It's 2-1, isn't it?
Ewen, what's your answer?
Oh, don't tell me.
What's your answer, Ewen? 2-1.
I was at a wedding when the game was on. I'm pretty sure
it's... The Flash of the Stage!
I'm going to give you the both teams and I'll get a bonus point for it. Can't even get the right score. And Steven, 3-1.
1-0.
I was at a wedding last
Inverness
year.
Inverness pulled a goal back and then Celtic scored again.
Yeah, right enough was the last couple of minutes, wasn't it? Yeah. Right, okay. It's 1-0, Steven. Jesus Christ. Right, okay, next question.
Good start, Ewen.
Shut up.
Name any Celtic player that made their debut in the 2-1 defeat to Clyde in 2006. Name any Celtic player who made their debut in the 2-1 defeat.
If I give, because I was in that game. If I give you two, can I get 2 points?
No.
Oh, for fuck's sake.
That's not how quizzes work, Ewen.
Right, I'm done.
You're done, okay, right, no problem. Steven, what was your answer?
My answer is Roy Keane.
Ewen, what was your answer?
My answer is Roy Keane. I do. Wayne was also another debut.
Correct, you, and that was the other name I had written down here. So well done, but it doesn't get you a bonus point.
Okay.
By the way, I watched the highlights of that game a couple of months ago.
I was there. It was a good game.
And why would you watch the highlights of that game?
No, it popped up as like, it was like, oh, a Scottish Cup classic or something like that.
Here we go again. I just happened to be watching that game.
And Clyde were absolutely tremendous that day. They were so good.
Who was in charge at the
time? Strachan.
Yeah, it was Strachan for Celtic and it was Graham Roberts.
Graham Roberts, that's for Clyde.
Yeah,
there you go. Right.
Do you know that Graham Roberts used to be a guest on the Real Radio Football Phone with me and Ruffy back in the day?
Jesus,
he worked with us for about 6 months. He used to come in every Friday. Right. Even when he was a Clyde manager.
Right.
He came in, he had some great stories.
I can't find my Real Radio jingle.
Good, because you don't need players.
It's the Real Football Phone-In with Ewen Cameron and Alan Ruff. Call now on 0845 100 2101.
What's Graham Roberts doing now?
I don't know.
Is he not involved in football anymore?
No idea. What? You knew him.
Sorry, I'll do my Joe Rogan thing now. Well, I'd find out what Graham Roberts is doing now.
Go on then, fact check it before we get to question three.
Fact check, what is Graham Roberts doing?
You think if he was involved in football, would have known about that?
I think Cassie's pals was daughter, I think.
Oh, really?
Graham Roberts.
How old would he be now as well?
Right, I'll fact check for you. Graham Roberts, he's 64.
Is he?
Wikipedia. He's on it. He's on Twitter. Oh, maybe that's a different Graham Roberts. former English footballer. He's a booking agent. Hold on.
For holidays?
No, he does speaking. He does speaking.
Public speaking.
Graham Roberts, legendary Tottenham and Chelsea defender.
He has got some great stories.
Did he play for you can book him for a speaker.
Yeah,
okay. But it doesn't say what he's up to.
Right, question number three. Let's get going.
And what year was the last Old Firm Cup final? And what year was the last Old Firm Cup final?
I was there that day, I think.
Were you there with the real radio football phone in you?
Me.
Yeah. It's 1 of 3 years. It's 1 of 3 years. Do you know what it is, Stephen?
I'm between two.
I'm between three. Now, did I?
Right, I've got my answer.
Was it the year of the UEFA Cup final in Seville? That was 2003 because I was there. Was that the same year as that? Was that Hampden that year for that? Or was it 2002?
Oh. 60 seconds, June. It's coming up. Write down an answer quickly!
I've done it. I went 2002.
2002 says Ewen Cameron. Stephen, what do you say?
I said 2002.
You're both right.
Look at that. I scribbled out three, put two. So I thought it wasn't the year of Seville. Thank God. Right. Thankfully, I remembered Seville.
3-2, Stephen.
Go, next one.
Next question. Out with Rangers and Celtic, which team has won the most Scottish Cups? Out with Rangers and Celtic, which team has won the most Scottish Cups?
Did we not talk about that the weekend?
I think we might have.
Did you not go through that list?
Yes, I think I did, but I can't remember.
Was it not like joint third or something?
I've got my answer.
Is it joint third because it's one of two teams? Or is there someone outright?
One outright, yeah.
One outright.
Mm-hmm. Stop checking on your phone, Ewan. Don't cheat.
I'm not cheating. It's my wife messaging me about what am I doing.
Ask her. She's probably got more of a clue.
Have you put an answer down? I've got an answer.
You got an answer.
I don't think I'm right, though. Oh, fuck, what happens here?
Right.
He'd go 4-2 up if he wins this one.
Yeah.
Is it not down? Oh, no.
Yep, that's what.
Yeah. If I've got. Oh.
Remember, there's no top bin really.
Yeah, I know, there,
Right, you can reveal your answer first, Jen.
Why?
All right, okay, I'll go first.
No, I'll go first. Right. I'll go first, and I've probably. I think I'm close, but I don't think it's the right answer.
What have you written down, Ewan?
Hearts.
Hearts.
I think we got 8 or 9, didn't we?
Stephen, who have you written down?
I've gone for Hearts.
Oh, I'm still in it. No matter what happens.
And Marshall has saved!
Aberdeen?
Yes!
Absolutely not. Come on, think about it.
Third lineup or something?
Queen's Park. We've won it 10 times.
Bollocks.
There you go.
Hearts have got 8.
Shame!
What do you mean, shite?
Exactly.
Because none of them were in the 1900s. They all done 18 at the start of their name.
Right.
Shite.
Right, so it's 3-2 going to the final question. I need him to get it wrong and for me to draw it.
Yeah. Here is the question.
That Inverness one at the start's going to kill me here.
Yeah, because you just rushed into that.
I know.
Who was in charge of Stennis Muir when they famously beat Aberdeen in 1995? who was in charge of Steny when they beat Aberdeen in 1990?
That's like a top bin question, you prick!
Well, you're both getting it, so...
Ewan, you're never going to believe this. Oh, I know the answer, but I watched the highlights of this game. Not that long ago. But I can't, honestly, I can't remember who the manager was.
Who was the manager? 19 what?
95.
Is it somebody we've heard of?
He's very... I would say he's... Yeah, I would say you've definitely heard of him.
Like, proper famous?
Not proper famous, but
proper Scottish cult, football
like
famous.
Proper Scottish football cult famous, yeah.
Cult famous?
I would say so, absolutely.
Well, cult figures like Dick Campbell now, it's not Dick. Like, is he still alive?
Aye.
Is he still involved in football?
I don't think so.
Would I have interviewed him?
He'll be a fair age now.
Would I have interviewed him?
Stop asking questions.
No, but would I have interviewed him at some point?
Doubt it.
Doubt it.
Just
going
to check if he's still alive. You need this, you. Oh, yes. Sorry, I was a bit tense. He's still alive.
Really. I don't know why I put this name down. I don't know. I've got no idea why I put this name down. Do you know?
I don't know.
I need you to see
as soon as you tell me who it is, I'll know exactly.
Right.
Right, okay.
So you need to get this wrong and for me to get it right.
Yeah.
So we'll reveal our answers at the same time.
Right.
Okay.
So in 3, 2, 1.
What have you written down? You and you went for Jockey Scott, Stephen.
John Brownlee.
John Brownlee.
I think it might be Jockey Scott. If that's the right answer, then fair play. It's somebody like that.
The answer is Terry Christie, which
Terry
means
Christie.
None of you are right, which means Stephen.
I'd never
wins
got Terry Christie
again.
In
the
a
duffel
million
coat,
years.
The duffel coat.
Yeah, no, I know, but I'd never got it in a million years.
That's like a top big question.
But
you
both got it, Ewan.
I don't care.
In the
first five questions. You don't do top bin questions, and that's a top bin question.
You got asked, what was the score in last year's Scottish Cup final?
And you got it wrong.
Get me wet wipes, I need to sweep the floor.
Right, okay, Ewan will sweep the floor. Sake. I win the quiz yet again,
right,
obviously.
Okay, we know you've won it. Just say cheerio, because we need to clean up.
No, you need to clear up. I'm not clearing anything up. Hit the music, John. Here we go. This has been the Big Scottish Football Podcast. A huge thank you to all for listening. And remember, you can get in touch on YouTube at Big Football Scott, on Twitter as well. You can leave your comments. We'll read out the best of them next week. And we'll get the wet wipes. Don't even worry about the wet wipes. So thank you very much for everyone who has been in touch. You can have your say on the big issues of the day in terms of what we are putting in the Scottish football bin, which is, of course, people putting their hands over their mouth when they're speaking on the pitch and stuff like that. So you can vote at Big Football Scott for that. Thank you to Mark the Hibby Gardner for that suggestion. And we'll be back next week with more chances to win with Scotty Brand as well. Hernan Crispo will be back. And, of course, it will be after the Scottish Cup final. Enjoy your week. We'll speak to you next Monday for some more chat. Ta-ra!